morning, ladies and gents. Can you hear me? Ladies and gentlemen, and we have actually quite a lot of ground to cover, so I'll try and keep my own comments, etc., to a minimum. We have one of our main speaker is actually based in the UK. It's 5 a.m. for him at this point in time. Swaminder Bush Ved, who I can see has joined us. And we have actually a surprise guest speaker, that's General Cardozo. And I'll just in a minute come on to the reason why he's here up on the podium with me. Now, as was covered in the previous session, we've seen how 71 was a classic example of what can be achieved by jointmanship, and also a textbook use of air power to attain operational objectives. Now, very, very quickly, what were the objectives of the Indian Air Force in the East during the 1971 war? First and foremost, as has been pointed out during the last session, was the attainment of air superiority so as to allow the Indian Army to carry out its operations unhindered. This is very, very critical and very, very important, as we've all seen. The second objective was to protect, of course, our own airspace, and as well as to provide protection to our own land and air assets on the Eastern Front. And the third, again, as has been pointed out, was to provide closer support to the army units in their assist them in their advance, and also to carry out interdiction and to disrupt the lines of communication of the Pakistani forces in the east. And lastly, one of the main objectives was to provide what they call vertical envelopment of the enemy through both special heliborne operations as well as airborne operations such as the airdrop at Tangail. Now, when we say special heliborne operation, what exactly is meant? It's essentially is the use of helicopters to land our own forces. They can either be special forces, paracommandos, or as in this particular case, an infantry battalion behind enemy lines. The idea is to either outflank them or to attain a certain tactical advantage. The very first heliborne operation in Indian military history was carried out in 1971 at the Battle of Sylhet, and we have with us Swaminder Bush Ved, who was one of the pilots who was engaged in the execution of this historic occasion. And we have General Cardozo, who was actually in one of those helicopters along with his battalion that was carried across the river and landed close to Sylhet, that led to a spectacular victory for Indian Army in that particular sector. Squadmeader Ved, very briefly I will introduce him and General Cardozo, and then I'll hand over to the speakers because we have a lot of time to cover, and I'm very conscious that there's very little time to do it. Squadmeader Ved was commissioned into the IAF in 1963. He's ex-NDA of the 21st NDA course, and he subsequently took voluntary retirement in 1974 and went on into the civil aviation sector. And during the war, he was serving as flight commander with 105 helicopter unit, flying MI-4s, and as I mentioned, was one of the was part of this first heliborne operation in Indian military history, for which he was awarded for his part of, in that operation, he was awarded the Veer Chakra. And General Cardozo, of course, needs no introduction, but I will very briefly, for those of you and the wider audience who may be listening to this online who do not know him, he joined the JSW, which is the Joint Services Wing, at Clementtown, Dehradun, in July 1954. I was going to say 1854, sir, but then he transferred to the National Defense Academy, Kharagwasna, in Jan 55, passing out in first in the Order of Merit, and was commissioned into the 1st Battalion, the 5th Gurkha Rifles, Frontier Force. And he was among the first recipients of the Sena Medal for a reconnaissance that he carried out in Niffa in 1960, and he saw action both in 65 and in 71. And as you're aware, in the latter war, he was severely wounded, losing a leg. And more important for the purpose of today's discussion, the action in which he received this wound was the Battle of Sylhet, which we will be talking about now. So, without delaying you any further, Squad Leader Wen, sir, good morning, and thank you for joining us at an early hour from the United Kingdom. And over to you, sir.
Good morning to you. Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me well.
Strength 5, sir.
I had the privilege of being the flight commander of the 110 helicopter unit when the war took place. And we were moved to Agartala area. And between the 3rd and the 6th of December, we were basically doing reconnaissance and casualty evacuation and supplying arms and ammunition to wherever the army wanted us to do. During the war, we did 4 special airborne operations. I'll talk about them as we go along. We lifted over 6,000 soldiers, over 202 tons of miscellaneous equipment for the army, and I don't remember the exact number of soldiers we carried or the amount of load we lifted, mainly because nobody was counting and nobody was keeping record. I had a small little diary in which I was making notes and whatever army told me and whatever the Air Force told me, my own pilots told me. But I can tell you this, that the Mi-4 helicopter is absolutely the most amazing helicopter I've flown. Very basic, but very, very reliable. And we were very, very fortunate that we had no accidents. And I'm also very, very grateful to all our engineers who kept all the helicopters flying all the time without any much resources. Sadly, none of them were recognized for all the efforts. And all the pilots and the flight engineers who are with me were amazing. Nobody complained of hunger, sleep, or sickness or anything. We just kept going. We were available 24/7. We slept an odd hour here and there, and we were flying during the day and during the night. And as far as the workload was concerned, nobody bothered. We just kept going. In terms of the war effort of the air assets or the sorties of drones or the pilots, I think we outdid any other air asset we had in the Air Force at that time. I'll just go on to the next slide now, please. This is the Mi-4 we flew. The Indian Air Force had that from 1962 to 1983. As I said, it was a very basic helicopter, and the only nav aid we had was the magnetic compass. But it was very reliable, and it never let us down. And I'll go on to the next slide, please. These are the people who were with me during the war. Of course, the senior officers you can see, but the main thing to look at is the junior officers. I was only 30 at that time, and most of the pilots were in early 20s. In fact, one of them was even a teenager at that time. When they arrived in our unit, some of them had come straight from the flying training school, so we had to train them. So we knew the war was coming, so by November of 1971, myself, Colonel Sandhu, and Jayaraman, Flag Captain Jayaraman, were able to train all of them and get them ready and make them operational so that during the war we had no problem. Next slide, please. These are the name of the people who were flying with me. We had 3 helicopter units involved. 110 was the main unit to which I belong. We had 9 helicopters from there and 20 pilots. The 105 helicopter unit had 3 helicopters and 8 pilots, and 111 helicopter had 2 helicopters and 4 pilots. Next slide, please. I'll take you on to the first operation we did at Sylhet. We were based in Agartala. From Agartala, we moved to Kailashar on the 7th morning and got ourselves ready. We made sure we had enough fuel for the whole operation. We got the helicopters refueled and fully loaded. All the passengers, all the air crew were briefed, and every aircraft had a number. I was number 1, and we had 8 helicopters for that particular operation, and we used 7 of them for the first 2 rotation and 8 for the third rotation. One was kept for casualty evacuation. Casualty evacuation always got priority because we didn't want anybody injured lying in the battlefield. At midday, we moved to Kalora, from where we were going to pick up the soldiers of 4-5 Gurkhas and take them to Silat. And Brigadier Bunty Quinn had come with Chandan Singh, and he had taken us in a chetak, and we had selected the helipad we wanted to land on. And we picked paddy fields on both areas. We made sure they were, especially in Silat area, they were far away from the Pakistan garrison. And at midday, as I said, we moved to Kalora, and we were waiting for 4-5 Gurkhas to come, and they had started arriving about 2:30 in the afternoon. My briefing to the crew was that every we'll only have one helicopter at Silat helipad at any one time, so that the target given to the enemy forces was only one small target, rather than having 2 or 3 helicopters sitting on the ground. So each helicopter took off with a gap of 2-3 minutes between each other. I was the first helicopter to go, and about 2:30 we took off, and I landed at Silat. We dropped our load, and the second helicopter was about 3-4 minutes behind me, and we made it like a circle. By the time I went back the second time, we had enough fuel to do 3 trips each. By the time I went back for the second operation, the Pakistan army had started surrounding us, and they were firing at us from all directions. And by the time we went for the third rotation, the amount of bullets we could see, the tracer bullets, there were hundreds and hundreds of tracer bullets coming. Amazingly, very few of us got any bullet holes, you know. So anyway, we landed, we dropped our load, and we came running back. And from the fuel was at Kalasha, so for Kalora, we had to come back to Kalasha, we refueled and get ready. While we were getting ready, the one of the engineers came and told me that one helicopter did not come back. We called him on the radio, and he said he's lost, so we fired a flare for him, and he came. He saw the flare, and he came and landed back. Then after refueling, we told Chandan Singh, we're ready to go. Chandan Singh said, no, we can't go because he had been flying with the Singla overhead Silat when the R operation was going on. And the bullets we saw were only the ones coming to us, but he could see the entire lot of bullets coming to all of us. So he said that no way any helicopter will survive going at night because we'll be like sitting ducks for them. So he said there'll be no flying at night. And that, of course, upset Lieutenant Colonel Horelkar, who was the commanding officer of 4-5 Gurkhas. And there was big discussion between him and, of course, Brigadier Quinn as well, and Chandan Singh as well, and to whether to send the helicopters at night or not. Eventually, they decided they will send one helicopter and see what happens. If it comes back safely, we'll send the rest of the helicopters. And he came and told me, this is what we're going to do, and get one crew and get one helicopter ready. So by the time I went to the crew room and asked the other somebody to volunteer, and everybody put their hands up. So I picked up one of the pilots flying off ready, and we got ready. Midnight we got airborne, and the army, the 4-5 Gurkhas had not even taken their HF radio with them in the first lot. So we took all the equipment with us, and luckily we had dropped our FAC, the Air Force Coordinating Officer. He had gone with the first lot, so he was over there. So once we got airborne, I knew where the helipad was at daytime. I knew what it looked like at daytime, but how I was going to find it at night was going to be amazing. I knew where the bridges were, I knew where the railway station was, but of course everything at night looks completely different. So once we got airborne, luckily our FAC came up on the radio, and he says, about ready time you guys came. And I asked him, what is the situation like? I'm so glad to hear his voice. And I said, what is the situation like on the ground? And he says, oh, it's very quiet, and I light a fire for you so you know where to land. So he lit a fire for us. So when I saw the fire, I went straight for it. I briefed my passengers that as soon as I land, I want everybody out, and we'll get airborne in 30 seconds. Which is exactly what we did. As soon as we landed, and everybody jumped out, While we were coming on finals, the mob of bullets that were coming towards me, I was sure I'd have at least a dozen bullet holes. Anyway, I dropped my load and I got airborne. Within a minute, I was airborne. I set course back to Kolora and asked my flight engineer, have a look how many bullet holes we got. He went around with the lights and the torch and everything, and after about 2 minutes, he came back, sir, with a big grin, sir, you'd be amazed, we don't have a single bullet hole. I was absolutely flabbergasted, amazed that the amount of bullets which had come towards us and nothing had hit us. I realized that the enemy could not see us, they were just firing at the noise. So I called up Kailasha, I said, come on guys, these people don't know how to fire, we're all going in now. So we got the rest of the helicopters getting ready. I came to Kolora, picked up my next load, went running back, dropped my next load, came all the way back, picked up my third load, and running back, dropped my third load and got airborne. On the third time when I got airborne, I suddenly realized my fuel gauge was showing zero. My engine was still running, my rotors are still running, so obviously we had fuel. So the three of us were praying to whoever they take us back home safely, which we did. We landed back at Kolora, and the engineers had a quick look after I shut down, and they found the cable, one bullet had come through, hit the cable going to the fuel gauge, and they of course replaced the cable. I refueled. In the meantime, four helicopters had got ready and they were at Kolora, and they started the operation, so I joined them. So the whole night we were flying that night on the 7th, then on the 8th the whole day we were flying, on the 9th the whole day we were flying. And then we came back to Kailasha, and then we moved from, on the 11th we moved to back to Agartala, and our next operation started. Next slide please, I can show you this is the direct line we took from Kolora to Silat. Next slide please. And this is the helipad, and you can see the railway station, and you can see the army garrisons and the two bridges on Soma. And we go on to the next slide, please. This is the next operation we did. Here, we are going to Raipura, and before we went to Raipura, we went to do a recce. In the recce, we found, in a little alleyway, I went with General Sagar Singh, and we went with Colonel Hamid Singh and Brigadier Mishra, and we located the helipad at airport, and we came back. On the way back, we were descending down. We were only six of us in the airport, and we suddenly heard foot noise and the bullet holes in the helicopter, and one of the pilots got injured. And when we came back to our base, we realized there were 38 bullet holes in the helicopter, and only one person was injured. Absolutely amazing. Anyway, that in the evening, we got ready and we landed at Brahmabariya to do the Raipur operation. And the whole night we were doing Raipur operation, and the next day we were doing Raipur operation, and we carried nearly 100 sorties and more than nearly 1,000 soldiers. We moved to Raipur. Next slide, please. And then once the Raipura was so successful, General Sagar Singh decided we'll go to Nalasingdi. So from Brahmabariya, we came back again in the evening. We had 10 helicopters by now. Then we did the Nalasingdi again. We did more than 100 sorties for Nalasingdi. And we carried out all the... And I'm just looking at the names of the different... Company, we lifted 10 Bihar, 18 Rajput, 33, 11 Mountain Brigade, 82 Light Artillery Brigade, followed by 59 Mountain Artillery Brigade, 65 Mountain Artillery Brigade, and 57 Mountain Artillery Brigade. And as I said, we carried more than 1,200 soldiers on that day, and over 100 sorties we did. And the next slide, please. Then, because the three SHPOs were so successful, Sagar Singh went to the, I think it was the last operation we did, the Dagakindi to the Vadya Badar. Yeah. And we can, that is on the 12th, 13th, and well, that's the fourth phase. We'll carry on to the next slide, please. I'm just trying to catch up with the time. And you can, and we, as you can see here, the breakdown of the people we carried to Sylhet, we had 649. From Raipura, we had 1,286. From Narasimhi, we had 1,570. And Pathia Bazar, we carried 2,408. And the total is given at the bottom, 6,000 soldiers. And as I said, we were working 24/7 with no sleep or anything. And we'll adjust for you the next slides, please. Just show you the photographs and carry on. We'll just carry on to the next slide, please. You can see the gun being carried across. It was broken up into pieces to fit into the Mi-4. The next slide, please. At Dadakundi and Narasimhi, there were no enemy anymore, so we were all flying in together now. And so we could, you can see four helicopters taking off and landing at the same time. Next slide, please. This is the first shot being fired by Colonel Bell into Dhaka on the 13th of December. And next slide, please. This is the Albert being flown by Flight Club Singla. It had a gun and rocket pads as well, which he used quite a lot during the war. And next slide, please. These are the two gentlemen I had the pleasure of flying with. And the next slide, please. This is the picture, a painting we got done. Group Captain Dave Gohan did it for us. They're landing at Narasimhi, and I think he's done a wonderful job by producing this lovely painting. I had to hurry it up because the time is coming up. So this is the last slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. That was fascinating, and it, you know, really brought those days back to life. We have with us today, as I mentioned, General Cardozo, who was part of the very first SHPO that was carried out at Sylhet. And I will now request General Cardozo to please share his reminiscences, sir, within about, say, 5 to 6 minutes.
Oh, 5 to 6 minutes is a lot of time. Ladies and gentlemen, yesterday I had already covered the operations at Sylhet as far as my battalion was concerned. I now only fill in the blanks as to what I did not say yesterday and what I need to say today. And that is that this was the quickest airborne operation in military history, whereas it takes days and weeks for the Army and the Air Force to get together to work out an operation like this. We got information at 7 o'clock in the morning. 9:30, the CO and Panti Quinn and Group Captain Chandan Singh went for the recce. When they did the recce, there was no response from the ground. So they said, see, what General Sagat is saying, there's nobody there. But by this time, they were alerted. And when the first flight went in at 2:30, there was little response. But after that, they gave us everything they had. They used machine guns, medium machine guns, small arms fire. But we had only 8 helicopters at that time, 2 were not in working order, and they went in waves of 4. Now you can't have 8 helicopters milling over the landing ground when so much fire is coming against us. So there's 4 of in each wave, going one at a time. And darkness falls very early in the east. So by about 4:30 it is already dusk. By 5 o'clock it's pitch dark. So the CO was very good. Colonel Harulikar, a very brave and courageous commanding officer, was worried because only the Charlie Company and the battalion headquarters, because he himself had landed. So there were just 252 people. And we had the whole of the 2 brigades and the garrison firing at us. So he spoke about contamination between the Army and the Air Force, Chandan Singh and Vijay Banti Quinn and Colonel Harulikar. Now, he rightly said, on the first day, on the 7th, the CO's wireless set was left behind, so we were not in contact. The GOC at Mountain Dew and Banti Quinn were at Kilora, they did not know what was happening till the helicopters brought in for getting back with the war wounded. Now, I will not talk about the pilots. The pilots were outstanding, as brought up by him. They were very young. They were very brave. They were courageous because the enemy was firing everything they had at us. But I think, as General Eric Waz said in the College of Combat High Command course, two factors favored us: God and good luck. And although the helicopters were peppered with bullet holes, we lost the adjutant who was wounded while landing, lost a couple of jawans, but the rest were safe. And as he said, the fuel lines and the engines were not damaged, so really God was with us. When he went back, I was not there, I come from Staff College. Early morning, I reached there at 3 o'clock, by 4:30 we were going in, and we had goosenecks, which was kettle-like contraption with kerosene oil, which is a small little flame to tell the helicopters where we were, because the enemy was with us. They could land in the enemy area. But the pilots were outstanding, and I hope they were suitably rewarded. But it was an amazing operation, and full credit to the Air Force. Later on, the enemy artillery had destroyed our MI room. We had lots of dead, we had lots of wounded, and it was bad for morale. The dead were lying around, the wounded were lying around. There was not even water to give them because the water was polluted. And we spoke to Chandan Singh and said, please send helicopters to get the dead and wounded out. They came on the 12th night and they evacuated the dead and wounded. They had no night flying capability. Yet they came at night. They came to the right area, they evacuated the dead and wounded. And I think there was not enough time for Captain Brain to talk about. But there were other aircraft involved. A caribou came on the 12th evening and dropped supplies. It was a sitting duck because they threw everything at it. It got badly damaged, but luckily it managed to reach its destination safely. So we don't have enough time to say anything more. But full marks to the Air Force. Not enough is known about their share in this wonderful victory. But as brought up by Luke Captain Ray, he did a wonderful job. And one of the main factors of victory was the capture of airspace, which allowed the army of ground troops to operate in every possible operation in the war.
Thank you very much, sir. Before I close, just a couple of things that I'd like to point out. Those of you may have noticed from the slide that was shown by Squadron Leader Ved, one of the CEOs of one of the helicopter units was then Squadron Leader Nanda Karyappa, who is Field Marshal Karyappa's son. Kilo flight, which he mentioned, which was at that time being trained by Squadron Leader Singla, became the de facto Bangladesh Air Force, because the pilots that were ultimately operating it were Bengali officers from ex-PAF. It now just remains for me to request you to please put your hands together for Squadron Leader Ved.
Would they do that? Can I say that?
Yes, please.
Nanda Karyappa is my post.
Oh, okay. So he, of course, he was shot down in 65, the last day of the war of flying hunters. And then after that, he came into helicopters.
And I'd like to say here, when he was shot down over Pakistan, Ayub Khan, who was adjutant to General Karyappa, repartitioned, rang up General Karyappa and said, "Your son is with us. I would like to return him now." General Karyappa said, "Sorry, all your prisoners are my sons. Treat him like anybody else." That is the value system which we were taught and we still live by.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you, Squadron Leader Ved. And ladies and gentlemen, another big round of applause for our panelists. Thank you. thank you, sir. Let you back to maybe catch up in your sleep. Thank you very much, Swami Dubey.